Good afternoon. Good afternoon. We have a good turnout today. Welcome. My name is Gay Minyi. I'm the Technical Director of the I4 Energy Center. I want to also welcome those that are viewing today's seminar on the internet. We have a great speaker today, Alex McCracken. He is the president of Power Standards Lab in Alameda. He's also the founder of Basic Measuring Instruments. He is the author of numerous works, including the Electric Power Measurements chapter of the Encyclopedia of Electrical and Electronics Engineering and the Industry Standard Handbook of Power Signatures. He's been awarded 29 U.S. patents and is probably working on more.
Yes.
Alex is very active in the International Standards Committee. He is the chairman of the IEC TC77A Working Group 9, which sets a standard for power quality instruments, and he is a senior member of IEEE. His expertise is greatly valued. He participates in several projects here on campus and up at LBNL, and his company's products are also installed here at LBNL. Among his many accomplishments, Alex is proud of the fact that the companies that he has created have been responsible for over 2,400 man years of employment. So to kind of put that into perspective, if the average man year salary is, let's say, $75,000, that's $180 million. So Alex, maybe you should give President Obama a call. Okay, let's welcome Alex.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Two things before I start. The title is OOPS. Somebody asked me if it was a four-letter acronym. No. It's just OOPS. Just OOPS. The other thing is that I'm going to be asking you to be sort of skeptical and questioning about this presentation. And I was just standing here feeling very good that so many of you came to hear it. But I have to ask you to be completely honest. By a show of hands, how many came primarily for the lunch? Seriously. Yeah. Well, no. I don't believe you. But, okay. That's good. This is going to be a very informal, hand-waving talk. It's not a lecture. It's not a technical presentation. But what I'm going to talk about is a bunch of problems that have shown up in various places on the grid because they weren't anticipated or because the assumptions were correct at the time but changed. So we'll talk about that. And at the end, I'd like to talk about some possible problems that we might think about that might come up with the smart grid. And the goal is that you leave here feeling healthy skepticism about everything, including what I've said. So, before we start, though, I want to ask a couple of questions about very familiar things. I'm not going to use this slide for a moment. When I parked out here on Hearst, I had to go pay at one of those kiosks, right? The little payment kiosks give you a little sticker. And it has a beautiful photovoltaic array, about that big, carefully sloped at about 35 degrees facing south. Good thing. If you look at them on Hearst, the north side of Hearst, every single one of them has a sign pole stuck in front of it with a sign completely blocking the photovoltaic array from the sun, saying this is where you pay. Stuff happens. Coordination. And just a couple of other familiar things that I'd like you to sort of ponder as you walk around. You've all seen this. Does anybody have any idea why we take 1,000-pound transformers and bolt them to the tops of rotten wooden poles in an earthquake area? It doesn't make intuitive sense to me. But to be honest, I never really thought about that until I started traveling overseas and looking at other power systems. So sometimes it's easier to see these kinds of assumptions when you've seen alternatives. And overseas, generally, especially in a built-up area like this, either the transformers will be underground in a vault, and that's the case everywhere in New York City, for example, or they'll be mounted on concrete pads, head mount transformers, but they're on at ground level. Or sometimes they're on concrete poles. A lot of the world, it's cheaper to use reinforced concrete poles than wooden poles. And wooden poles, as you all are probably aware, tend to rot at the interface between the earth and the air, because things like to grow right at interfaces, just like they grow along the edges of the... There's a lot of biodiversity along the edges of the bay, on the edges between a forest and a meadow. But you get a lot of biodiversity at the edge between the earth and the air and these wooden poles. So that's where they tend to rot. In some countries, I was just in Vietnam, there are a whole bunch of very short wooden platforms. They're high enough that you can't quite reach up onto them, but they're not putting the transformers way up in the air. And here's a good example of a concrete, reinforced concrete pole. This one's in China. This is typical transformer installation out in agricultural England. And that is a pole up on a transformer up on a pole in Brazil. But again, it's a reinforced concrete pole. So at least as you walk around, look at the grid and say, huh, look at that. There's a giant transformer up there. The other thing I'd just like you to question, this looks like a normal outlet, right? That's what you'd kind of expect. But for those of you sitting along the edges, look at the outlets in the walls. The ones in the walls are installed correctly. This one's upside down. And the reason they're supposed to be installed the other way up, as all of these are, this one is too, here, this is the ground pin here, right? That's the ground pin. And that one's safe to touch. That's the one you're supposed to be able to touch. Now, if that outlet were the other way up and the plug wasn't pushed in all the way and a knife or a fork fell down behind it, not a problem, it bounces off. But when they're installed this way up and a knife or a fork falls down behind it, there's a loud, horrible crackle. Yeah? They're supposed to go the other way up. What are these others? Why three conductors? I don't know how much you guys are into the electrical grid, the end use point. You got to have two conductors to transmit power. Well, that's easy enough. But the ground conductor is a way of ensuring that there is a conductor that's attached to the earth, just like you are personally when you're standing in a wet, conductive area. So particularly in bathrooms and kitchens and places like that, where you're connected to the earth, it's good to have the metal package around your toaster or your toaster oven to also be connected to the earth. Why is it this shape? It turns out that very early on, big arguments between Edison and Westinghouse and a young man named Hubble about exactly what these things should look like, whether they should be two blades that go in this way or two blades that go in this way or one blade like this and one blade like that. And it wound up settling down essentially on two parallel blades. The reason that isn't used in most of the rest of the world is it's a very bad design. If you have experience with it. If your hands are slippery and you're pushing a two-prong plug into an outlet, it's very easy for your fingers to slip forward and touch the two prongs as it goes in. That turns out to personal experience, that's very uncomfortable because not only are you getting shocks where you have lots of nerve endings, but the shock is activating all these muscles right here, and you're grabbing on tighter and tighter. It's a bad design. But like many bad designs, it's become conventional, and so we just use it. It's very difficult to change well-established convention. You notice all of these are near the floor, right? When they were first put out, when Edison was first doing electrification, the outlets in general were put in the center of the ceiling, because there was a mental map that that's where the gas was for the lights, and this was a replacement for gas, so you put the outlet up there. You look at a lot of old pictures, early electrification pictures, you'll see power cords plugged in up there and then sort of draping across the room to a sewing machine or a fan. dangerous, so you'll find some houses built in the 1890s that have the outlets on the wall, but it's just below the ceiling. Because those outlets go up high, of course. They should be in the ceiling, but it's safer over there. And then they move about halfway down the wall, and then they finally settle in the 30s down along the bottom there. But I'm just trying to encourage you to glance at outlets and say, huh, I wonder why it is that way. How many of you are power system people? Electric power system? Okay, a mix. In a single-phase power system, what you have coming out of here, out of the outlet, you have two conductors that are carrying the power. It's alternating back and forth this way. But there's just two conductors actually carrying the power. And there actually isn't any reason for them to be associated with Earth. No obvious reason. The reason that in many power systems one of those conductors is grounded is that it gives you an opportunity or a way to avoid both conductors floating away from Earth to some unknown level. So there are systems out there where neither conductor is attached to Earth. That's very common on ships, for example, because part of the assumption on a ship is there's so much corrosion and conduction around that it's very likely that one of the conductors is going to be attached to ground accidentally. But part of the assumption, it's not really necessary to attach one of the conductors to ground. Think about a Boeing 747. You know, its electrical system works just fine. And there's no attachment to ground up there at all. Now, they do use the metal frame and skin of the 747 as a kind of ground. But now the 787 has all this carbon fiber stuff, skins and structure that aren't conductive at all. So it's not absolutely necessary to attach one of the conductors to ground. Once you do decide to attach one conductor to ground, you got a couple of problems. One is that an animal or a person who is standing on ground and touches the other conductor now has 120 or 240 volts across them. And that's bad for the animal and bad for the person. The other problem is that if you take the conductor that is not attached to ground and have the insulation on it fail, and then it touches ground, you get lots of current if the other conductor is grounded. And that can be a good thing or a bad thing, because you have to make a decision what you want to have happen when insulation fails on the power grid. It does fail. One of my recent amusements has been buying instruments that I designed for measuring electric power back when I was a young guy. You can buy them on eBay now. And, as classic, and sometimes, I'm embarrassed to say, sometimes they show up in the antiques section. But, you can buy them and they're cheap. And one of the things I found is that for electronic instruments built in the 1970s, generally speaking, they still work very well, except for the rubber insulation on the power cord. It's all cracked and broken, and the electrolytic capacitors, which are all dried out. So when the insulation cracks and breaks, what do you want to have happen? If you want that to trip a circuit breaker or blow a fuse, then you want to have the other conductor solidly connected to Earth. But if you want to continue operating, even if the insulation's broken and it's touching the shield, touching the metal enclosure, then you don't want to have the other one solidly connected to ground. So, for example, a lot of the military combat systems are ungrounded. That way you can destroy the insulation on one side. It doesn't have any effect. Around the world, there's lots of different ways of connecting the grid to ground. Through some sort of impedance. In North America, we use 0 ohms. We just connect it. But in some countries, they use about 100 ohms. That gives you a ground reference, that the two conductors don't float away from ground, but limits the amount of current that's available for hurting people. It also limits the amount of current that's available for tripping circuit breakers. In southern France and a couple other places, you find these resonant connections on grounds. Those are set up so that they connect one of the conductors to ground at every frequency except the power frequency, which is kind of an interesting way of avoiding hurting people. And then there are various other mistakes that go on. Another question that shows up is, just to get you thinking about get you away from the assumptions that the way we do it is the correct way. You know, this outlet, the ground pin, is connected to the neutral pin back of the transformer. But there's no reason not to connect the other pin to ground, and there's a lot of arguments for connecting the center between the two conductors to ground. And that is done, this one here, is done in almost all North American houses. You got 240 volts end-to-end and a neutral in the middle, and you got 120 and 120, and ground is attached to the neutral. But even on 120 volts, in high-end audio recording studios, they will split the 120 volts and ground the center, so you only have 60 volts to earth on each of the conductors. On three-phase systems, we're very used in North America to seeing the ground being the center of the three phases, but in Japan, they say that's the waste of a conductor. We'll just ground one of the conductors. You know, it's a completely different approach to where to put ground, but no reason not to do it. And then sometimes in North America, we'll do something like this where we ground the center of one of the three phases. So lots of different ways of doing it, and occasionally you run across something that is just flat out wrong. Ground is the only conductor where you can count on the color code. Everywhere in the world, ground is green with a yellow stripe. Everywhere. Green by itself, not so much. In China, in one power configuration, green is one of the phase voltages. So if you get a piece of equipment from China and it has a green conductor on it, don't assume that that's earth. That can be very painful. But here, what you see is a copper bus bar with ground and neutral connected together over and over again, and that's a very bad idea because it causes half the neutral current to flow in the ground conductor. But we'll skip that and get on to the main point. The main point I want to show you are sort of what I think of, and it has to be sort of a personal opinion, but what I think of as mistakes that we've made in several places, in standards particularly because that's my interest, but also because the electric power grid is driven in large part by standards worldwide. It's driven by standards because it's such a dangerous thing and it's placed all over where it's accessible to people. And so it's necessary to have a consensus about how to build it. You can't have everybody coming up with a new design for every instance of a power system, or you'll wind up with what the United States has done with nuclear power plants and design a new one every time we build a new one, instead of what France did, where they're all the same. So four standards that contain something that I think are sort of strange or accidental problems. The first one I feel quite comfortable complaining about because I'm the chairman of it and responsible for it, and it's got this terrible problem in it. 61430 is the international standard on how to measure power quality. And all sorts of different power quality problems need to get measured, and there's chapters on how to measure each one of them. The reason a standard is necessary is that you can have two perfectly accurate, true RMS instruments, and you connect them both to that outlet there, and when there is a voltage sag, a brief reduction in voltage for a fraction of a second, when there's a voltage sag, they will give you two different readings. And the reason, it's pretty straightforward, it's in the definition of RMS, the root of the mean of the square of the voltage. And the square of the voltage everybody agrees on, and the root of the voltage squared, everybody agrees on that. But the mean, the average, can be taken over one cycle, it can be taken over five cycles, you can take it over a minute, lots of different possibilities. So because of those kinds of disagreements in instruments, this standard was developed to say, all right, you will take the RMS voltage over the course of one cycle. That's it. More complicated than that, but that's it. And it covers frequency measurement and lots of other kinds of disturbances. However, this standard also covers something called over-deviation and under-deviation, which is a power quality problem nobody outside of Quebec, Canada has ever heard of. And this is a challenge because, you know, these standards are used in China and in Germany and in South Africa and in Israel. And the first question I always get is, what is this over and under deviation stuff? The idea is pretty straightforward. Suppose the utility says that it's our responsibility to keep the voltage within plus or minus 10%. And this standard says this is how you measure plus or minus 10%. Well, utilities in general like to specify measurements or requirements over a time scale that's roughly equivalent to the thermal time constant of a transformer. 10 minutes, 15 minutes. You know, if I suddenly draw 100 amps from this outlet, the transformer that's feeding this room, if I do it for only 1 second, it doesn't care. If this building is rated for, you know, 500 kilowatts, and for 3 seconds it draws 800 kilowatts, the transformer isn't going to heat up. 10 minutes is what everybody uses in the rest of the world. 15 minutes is what we use in North America. So what the utility says is, yeah, we'll keep the voltage within plus or minus 10% on average over 15 minutes. Make sense? Yeah, well, it's perfectly reasonable. But as these very bright engineers from Quebec pointed out, that means that the utility could deliver you 50% volume, 60 volts here for 5 minutes, and what would it be, 180 volts for 5 minutes, and on average, 120 volts, the voltage is perfect. Yeah? So this particular engineer said we must resolve how to measure that so that it doesn't happen. We should split the under-deviation voltages, the 60-volt times, from the over-deviation voltages and produce two different sets of numbers for voltage that's low and voltage that's high. Well, the way these standards are written is that there are groups of engineers, typically one engineer from each country that's involved in writing the standard, and these groups meet once every 6 months to hash out the standards. And you start with a blank piece of paper and you work till you pretty much all agree. You meet in a different city around the world every 6 months so that nobody has to travel everywhere. You know, somebody hosts it somewhere. And this particular problem was a big issue when this working group actually met in the faculty club at Berkeley. And this one representative from Canada insisted that this measurement be included in the standard. None of the rest of us had heard of it. We were reluctant to standardize on it. We kept saying no. He was insistent and insistent and insistent, and we couldn't move forward because he insisted so strongly. And these meetings are only 3 days, and there's a lot of work to get done. We couldn't move forward, and it was getting towards the end of the second day, and he was still blocking things and saying, we're not going to move on until we get this in. And he finally said, look, if you put this in the standard, I will buy everybody a beer after this meeting. And we said, oh, all right, put it in. So now, I know personally, I thought in the back of my mind, yeah, we'll put it in and I'll take it back out later. And it didn't get taken out. And the first edition of the standard got out there, and lots of instruments were built to measure according to it. And lots of countries started adopting it as their national method of measuring power quality. And when Edition 2 came, And I said, okay, now it's time to remove this section. There was a lot of opposition from Brazil, from Colombia, from Mexico, from Australia, saying, no, that's now part of our national standard. You can't remove it. So it's still there. So the moral is that when you're looking at these standards, it's worth asking why they say what they say. And sometimes you need to realize that it's just people. They're not magic things carved in stone. It's just a bunch of people sitting around the table trying to get enough votes together to get this thing through. Completely different standard, 61,047. This is the standard on how to measure harmonics. And for those of you who aren't in the power biz, the electric power end, the entire grid is designed to work on either 50 hertz or 60 hertz sine waves with respect to time. It expects sine wave voltage, and it expects sine wave current, and that's what it was all designed for. But a lot of newer equipment, like variable frequency drives and these lovely incandescent lamps that are running from lamp dimmers, don't draw sinusoidal current. They draw pulses of current. And one way to describe that is you can say it's a pulse like this and draw a picture, or you can do Fourier transform on it and say it's got these harmonics. All the harmonics mean those. It's not a sine wave. Now, this particular standard says this is how you will measure harmonics. And it was originally written back in the 70s for measuring the harmonics emissions of things like computers. So you got a standard that says a computer should not put out more than 6% total harmonic distortion on its current, or whatever the number is. And this standard says this is how you measure it. You measure it up to the 50th harmonic, and you measure it 5 times per second so you can make sure that it's not doing something silly, and that's how you measure current harmonics. Well, that works very well when you're measuring harmonics for a thing in a laboratory, and the output of your measurement is yes, it meets the requirements, or no, it doesn't. But when you start going out onto the grid and trying to do surveys, how much harmonic current is flowing out of this substation? Well, there you're not really interested in 5 times a second measurement. In fact, you're overwhelmed by that. What you're really interested in is harmonics once a minute or once every few minutes. And maybe you're not really interested out to the 50th, maybe you are. But it's vastly less data because you're not trying to reduce it to yes, it passed, no, it didn't pass. You're trying to manage all of this data, and once a minute would be plenty. However, it's not possible to get that standard to change. And the reason is that that standard is controlled by a working group that also writes the emissions limits standards, the harmonics emissions limit standards for equipment like computers and variable frequency drives and compact fluorescent lights. Within that working group, there are two opposed groups, more or less. There are the utility companies whose goal is to tell the equipment makers you must lower the amount of harmonics emissions you put out because those harmonics cause overheating and reliability problems on our grid. Then there's the equipment makers who say, but there are not any harmonic problems on the grid. They don't exist yet. Well, the utilities say, well, but we have to anticipate them. We have to take care of the problem before it happens. And the equipment people say, but you're asking us to spend money to fix a problem on your grid that doesn't exist. And as a result, with those two groups, all of the work sort of has come to a stop. You can't get anything to change because you have these diametrically opposed groups that simply haven't found a way to compromise or to find some reasonable technical solution. And as a byproduct of that, they can't get around to changing the measurement method. for doing surveys. So once again, even when it comes down to people, when you've got these standard, you've got the standard in front of you that says this is how you measure harmonics. You look at its publication date. It's been revised or reapproved in 2010. You think that this is fully up to date. It isn't. It's stuck somewhere 7 or 8 years ago, but it's stuck because of people's motivation. Yeah. Back when we were first thinking about writing standards for connecting wind turbines to the grid, we were thinking in terms of little wind turbines like this, because that's what existed back in the 70s. Little, you know, little things. And so the general philosophy was the wind turbine is responsible for matching the local grid voltage, frequency, and phase angle. It's got to match itself up and blend in nicely. And if it can't, the wind turbine must disconnect itself from the grid. This sounds perfectly reasonable, right? You're just saying these wind turbines aren't allowed to screw up the grid. If they're going to screw up the grid, they have to disconnect. But it turns out that once you get huge wind farms that are providing huge amounts of the power to a city, this is in China. Yeah, this is in China. What happens, for example, when there is a voltage sag on the transmission line between the wind turbine farm and the giant substation in the city? Well, voltage sags happen because, I don't know if you can see, but there are a couple of bird's nests here. Okay, they happen when some inadvertent short circuit happens on the transmission line or the distribution line. Well, when that happens, the voltage goes boom. And all of these wind turbines are busily following this rule that says, I'm supposed to match the voltage, the frequency, and the phase angle. And the voltage just went, and the phase angle just went, and one or two of them can say, this was a problem a few years ago, can say, oh, I can't follow that. I must disconnect myself. When they disconnect themselves, of course, there's less energy available, the phase angle shifts more, and the voltage drops more, and other wind turbines disconnect themselves, and it kind of goes, and the whole thing goes, it disconnects. Now, that, when you disconnect one of these guys, it doesn't have any effect on the grid. But when you start having wind farms that are generating, you know, 500 megawatts, 1,000 megawatts, and they all disconnect all at once, that's a huge hit to the grid. And it's just a change in assumptions. Back when we were first working on this stuff, all those years ago, our assumption was wind turbines are an insignificant source of power. You can take them off the grid with no problem at all. That was wrong. Wind turbines became a significant source of power, so you got to change the standards. Voltage flicker. Voltage flicker is a problem on the grid where the voltage is moving up and down a very small amount, 0.5%, less than 0.5%, but is doing it at a frequency that happens to be particularly effective for your peripheral vision. It turns out your peripheral vision is optimized for detecting motion. You know, your central vision is for detecting edges and colors, and peripheral vision is for motion. And you can see that by moving your fingers back till you can't see them and then wiggling them. And you can see them if they're wiggling, but you can't see them if they're just back there. And if you think about it a little bit, you'll realize that wiggling fingers or motion is exactly the same thing as varying light intensity. And your peripheral vision has a peak in its sensitivity at about 10 hertz, more or less. It tapers off at around 4 hertz, but around 10 hertz. And unfortunately, if you vary the line voltage by 0.5% at 10 hertz, it becomes extremely annoying if you're trying to read, and you don't know why. Because all you can see is something's over there, but the moment you look over there, the problem's over there. And you look over there, and you, if you watch somebody in a room that's got a lot of flicker problems, they're doing this, you know, and it's kind of distressing. Now, where do flicker problems come from? Two big sources. One is arc furnaces. Arc furnace is typically this giant ceramic pot loaded with ore or some unrefined metal. And you lower into it three telephone pole-sized electrodes that are directly connected to the distribution grid, 24,000 volts typically. And when they hit the metal, it makes a big arc. The metal runs away from the arc as it melts and runs out the bottom of the ceramic pot. And so the arc gets longer and longer from the end of these electrodes until finally it goes out because it's too long. And then the moment the current stops flowing, these electrodes have motors at the top that drive them down to start the arc again. So it melts away and drives them down. So they are dead short circuits on the distribution grid, alternating with no current at all. So thousands of amps, no amps, thousands of amps. And unfortunately, it makes and breaks at about 10 hertz. Yeah, just by coincidence. Bad luck. The other bigger issue these days, it's one that's just, it was new to me until a few months ago, are car shredders. Paper shredders, right? You've all seen paper shredders, and you're all engineers. You know how a paper shredder works because you look at them, right? They got these steel fingers interleaved with this rotating wheel that has projecting teeth on it that tears through the paper. And car shredders work exactly the same way, except you feed in cars instead of paper, and you shred them. You know, and apparently that makes it cheaper to transport the resulting stuff for rework or recycling. Unfortunately, the motors that are driving these giant shredding wheels are geared so that the shredding wheel happens to have roughly one tooth about 10 times per second, chewing into a car. So the current they draw pulses upwards 10 times per second by a large amount. And the whole neighborhood starts seeing flicker. Okay, so there is a standard that says this is how you measure flicker. And it incorporates, it says you measure the voltage, and then you run it through this filter that represents the time constant of an incandescent light. And then you run it through this filter that represents the sensitivity of an average person's peripheral vision, although it turns out when you look back in all the data, it means the average male undergraduate German perception. And there are, it turns out that there are a bunch of studies that show that Asian peripheral perception is significantly different than average male undergraduate German. So it's got this incandescent light curve and this peripheral vision curve, and then it's got a bunch of other statistics in it, and here's your result. And the whole idea has been reasonably successful and reasonably useful for many years, but now we've banned incandescent lights, right? So the whole standard is built around incandescent lights. And it turns out that compact fluorescent lights don't flicker at all. Because if you move their RMS voltage, they essentially have a DC supply inside them. The DC supply doesn't vary by a percent when you vary by a tenth of a percent. So it turns out that the problem has gone away, more or less. It will. It's in the process of going away. Now, this is purely my opinion, but the reason that this standard continues to be a horrifically expensive standard to implement all over the world is twofold. Not that it's useful anymore, but one reason is that there is a technical community that is dedicated to the flicker problem. And there are three or four experts in every country in the world who focus entirely on flicker and publish papers about flicker and work on the standard about flicker, and that is their lifelong focus. So it's difficult for them to say, that's enough. You know, we don't need that one anymore. But the other problem is what I think of as sort of the Genesis problem, you know, where you have Adam and Eve and they begat Cain and Abel and they begat, you know. The same thing happens in standards. 61,415 is a standard. However, it is referenced by 61,430, which is the power quality measurement standard, saying you should use that for measuring flicker. And this one is referenced by lots of national standards, saying this is how you must measure power quality. So it becomes very difficult to kill a standard once it's propagated out and has been adopted in lots of other standards. And the only thing I can think to say about that is that we have these wonderful systems for creating standards in the industry, and we have almost no system for killing them. And we need to work just as hard at getting rid of them as we work at creating them. But there's always a big community of people who are invested in maintaining them as opposed to killing them off. So all of these sort of the things that went wrong and skepticism, just quickly apply it to the smart grid. The first question, what is the smart grid? And at smart grid conferences, you can usually get a big laugh by asking that question because nobody knows what the smart grid is. We just all know we're in favor of it. How could you be in favor of the dumb grid? You know? But in general, the smart grid is let's match the load to the available generation as opposed to what we do today, which is crank up the generation to whatever the load needs. So we can adjust the load in addition to adjusting the generation. Second thing it is it has something to do with a grid that can reconfigure itself to repair problems or to maximize reliability. Because right now, when we're trying to get power from, I don't know, from San Onofre nuclear power plant in Southern California up to Fresno, we might be using this transmission line, but it might be more efficient if the big loads are over here to bring it up that transmission line and back over this way. And you can do the same thing at the distribution level. If this building needs more power, it might make more sense to bring it in from over there instead of bringing it in from the central plant back over there. We can increase the efficiency by reconfiguring the grid on the fly and optimizing it. The third point that everybody agrees on is that we ought to maximize the connectability in the smart grid for distributed generation, photovoltaics, wind turbines, fuel cells, things like that. And finally, we ought to be encouraging energy-efficient loads, which maybe is part of the smart grid, or maybe it isn't. And all of this, really good idea. You know, that's no argument with any of that. But let's talk about what might happen, at least, you know, not an argument against the smart grid, but what could go wrong if you decide to reconfigure the grid that's feeding this building? Well, one thing that'll happen is that there will be switching events. I'm going to list that. Because obviously something physically has to switch from power over there to power coming from over there. And there are ways of solving that, but it's something to think about. However, it would make the point of common coupling impedance a variable. The point of common coupling is the point at which this building joins all the other buildings. So electrically. So there's probably one big service entrance coming into this building, one big set of bus bars or a big set of cables, and that's the point of common coupling. The impedance there is, think of it as how much current is available into that physical point. If you put a dead short circuit downstream from that point, how much current would flow? And if you change the impedance, here's what happens. If you increase the impedance, then when this building suddenly draws more current, say the air conditioning motors turn on, the voltage in the building will drop. It's exactly analogous to what happens in your shower when somebody flushes the toilet. You've got a limited source impedance, pipes coming into your bathroom, and if the source impedance is high, pipes are small, then when somebody draws a bunch of current, flushes the toilet, the pressure goes down, the voltage goes down. Okay, that's a very precise analogy. So if you increase the impedance coming into this building, there will be more voltage sags in this building and sensitive loads will have more problems. If you decrease the impedance, then more current is available. And the problem here is the circuit breakers for this building. Circuit breakers. A circuit breaker, physically, you just got a couple of contacts sprung together like that. And if too much current flows, they fly apart. That's what a circuit breaker is. But as they fly apart, they start out very close together, and so there's an arc. And they pull apart, and they draw a big old arc between the contacts. And the energy in that arc is the portion of the voltage drop across it, and how much current is flowing through it. And the current is proportional, in effect, when you get all done with it, to the source impedance. Because you've got a short circuit on this side of the circuit breaker. So if you lower the source impedance by reconfiguring the grid, you get more energy in the arcs inside the circuit breakers. And circuit breakers, they're physical things. You put enough energy into them, they explode. I mean, I had a picture of an exploded breaker back here somewhere. There. Here. This is a circuit breaker here. Here. That more. It was rated for interrupting, I forget, 50,000 amps. And there was 100,000 amps available, and it just explodes. That's what circuit breakers do. So if you lower the source impedance, let's get there. If you lower the source impedance for the, whoops, here we go. If you lower the source impedance, you wind up creating harsher requirements for the protective devices downstream from there. And they may not be set up to deal with that. Now, if you lower the source impedance, you also increase the efficiency of the grid. It's a good thing. But you may wind up having problems with your protective devices. The other problem is harmonic impedances. Right now, I should back up. The grid out there in general are wires sticking on poles, right? The distribution grid. And those look pretty much like inductors. And then every once in a while, we hang a big old power factor correction capacitor across them, and now you got series inductors and a big parallel capacitor, and that's a resonant circuit, and the whole thing will resonate typically at a few hundred hertz, that kind of ballpark. You can be sure that it doesn't resonate at a multiple of a harmonic frequency, because if it did, then there would be huge voltage harmonics whenever there were any current harmonics. And current harmonics are very common. Voltage harmonics, not so much so. Again, voltage harmonics just means the voltage isn't a sine wave. That's all. So the grid, as it is configured now, doesn't have a problem with harmonic resonances. And you know that because there's no voltage. However, if you reconfigure the grid, you can create new harmonic resonances. And nobody's quite sure if that's going to happen or if it won't. And it depends very much on how the grid is reconfigured and how much of a change it's going to be. But at the very least, we ought to be paying attention to the possibility that we're going to get changes in fundamental impedance, either higher or lower would be a problem, or changes in harmonic impedance. Now, second thing is, we're talking about making the grid friendlier to distributed generation. Houses with photovoltaics, wind turbines, things like that. The basic mental model of power, the power grid today, is you got these big generators in dams and nuclear plants and fossil fuel plants that take energy and they put it on the transmission system, which carries it long distances to a substation, and then at the substation it goes out on substation feeders that go out to the actual end loads out at the end. The transmission system is designed from the start to carry power in either direction. You can send power up and down I-5. You can send it north, you can send it south. It's designed for that. The distribution feeders are designed with the assumption that power will flow from the substation out to the load. And once we start putting generators out there, that assumption is no longer true. So there's sort of an analogy here. Suppose I have this outlet here, and I run a cable out, and I put a 120-volt bulb in your lap. There we go. Okay. And the power is going to flow that way. And we put a little fuse here that says more than half an amp, we're going to blow the fuse. Okay? Because we have a 60-watt light over there. So we got a half-amp fuse there and a 60-watt bulb there. And that's a perfectly reasonable protection scheme. Now, suppose we size the wires to carry half an amp. That's what we got. And we have a half-amp fuse. That's perfectly sensible. Now, where things get screwed up is if I suddenly clip on a generator right here that pushes in an extra 2 amps and a load right here that draws 2 amps, okay? Now there's half an amp coming out of the outlet. The fuse doesn't blow. The wires are rated for half an amp, but I'm pushing an extra 2 amps through them right here, and the protection device, the fuse, never blows. Conceptually, that's the problem. You're starting to add generation sources at points where it's not really ready. There's also an issue with phase angle stability. Basically, the issue is these great big traditional generators don't change phase angle very quickly, but these little electronic ones change very, very rapidly. And I'm going to skip the whole discussion of FIDVR. All of this is not to say we shouldn't do the smart grid. It's a good idea, but we got to question what bad things might happen. And finally, just in conclusion, it'd be really nice if you were skeptical about what you see out there and ask questions about why they are what they are. And it's kind of an oxymoron, but when you see big changes getting proposed, ask what the unanticipated consequences might be. Of course, you're anticipating what they might be, so they're unanticipated. But, you know, there you are. And with that, I've run over my time, so I'll just open it up for questions or comments.
Questions? I'll start off with one then.
Yeah.
Concerning those potential harmonics when you reconfigure the grid in a smart grid environment, are there simulations that you can do in advance to try to predict some of these potential harmonics?
Yeah, you could certainly simulate them. The problem is, I don't know if there's a whole lot of data available about where inductive loads and where capacitive loads are on the grid. So you certainly could simulate them speculatively. You couldn't simulate them trying to predict what's actually going to happen when you reconfigure the grid.
Now, I think there's probably talk of putting in, single phases type measurements at the distribution level, so you maybe in the future be able to see what actually happens.
Exactly. That's why I'm working so hard on that. Yes. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
There's a lot of proposals for putting storage devices on the grid, all in many different places, small and large. How do you see this problem being handled in terms of standards?
It's a lovely challenge. I don't, from a technical perspective, see much difference between a storage device and a generator, except that you can call on the storage device whenever you want it. So from a grid stability point of view, it's a wonderful thing. But I think the same problems will show up with the generators, distributed generators. You're running power on the distribution lines in a direction that they weren't designed for. I think the most likely effect is a lot of our rules of thumb will stop working.
I enjoyed your talk. I just wanted to get kind of at the philosophical basis of what you're offering here. I mean, it seems to me you're saying, look, you have to move somewhat slowly because you don't know what's going to happen because of the way we've built up the system. And that would lend itself, that's a philosophy that's normal, like if I'm upgrading my road system and so on.
Yeah.
But a lot of the pressure on the electrical system today is decarbonization.
Yeah.
And so there's a need to accelerate things. So within that context, what would be the approach, what would be a systematic approach to think about the potential weak points and problems that occur.
Yeah.
As opposed to just philosophically saying, hey, bad things tend to happen when you change the system fast.
Well, I wouldn't say they happen when you change the system fast. I think they happen when you make big changes. And I would not argue that we ought to slow down. But I guess an awful lot of engineers I talk to around the world think that, well, we'll make this change and these good things will happen. And they simply don't think about the accidental, unintended problems. So I would not argue that we should slow down. I would argue that we ought to be aware as engineers and as researchers that very good things can come out of changes that we make, but there probably will be some problems. What are those problems going to be? Let's think about those and talk about those too. I don't know, but I appreciate the question.
How would this smart grid reconfiguration be different from the manual reconfiguration now?
Ah.
It seemed like the impedance problems would be pre-existing.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. The difference is that in the smart grid, we're talking about doing a lot more of it at a lot more locations, a lot more frequently. So right now, yes, you reconfigure grids manually and you reconnect this one here. But you do that once a month, every 2 months, when there are big changes in the load. With the smart grid, we're talking about doing it on an hourly basis. And the other thing, of course, is the smart grid, if it's fully implemented, it'll be going on all over the place, not just at a few substations moving switches from here to there.
Okay, I think no more questions. Okay, thank you, Alex.
Well, good. Thank you. Thank you for the time.